What is there, four over there, Jessica? Four beside you? Four? Some in there. You got four, just a couple rows ahead of that too, Danny. Is that third row open? Is it? Okay. Third row is open on this side, guys, all the way. Six of them right over here. Okay. Got plenty of room over here if you need it. It's got six seats. Okay. You okay? All right. We'll get started here in just a moment.
If you would, in your hymnal, 281, we have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. It's on the inside of your bulletin if you need, or you can open your songbook. Would you stand with me as we sing, Jesus saves, we have heard the joyful sound on that first all together. We have heard the joyful sound, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Spread the tidings all around, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Bear the news. Mighty voice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Let the nation now rejoice, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout salvation full and free, highest hills and deepest caves. This our song of victory. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
Good singing this morning, and welcome to our Turkey Dinner Day Sunday, and glad you've come to be with us. We're honored that you're here. Looking forward to a wonderful, wonderful morning together, and boy, have we got a great meal for you after the service today, and I tell you, I won't talk about it because you'll want to quit and leave right now and go eat, so we'll wait a little bit on that, but you will get a ticket at the end of the service, and that'll get you in the line and get you a meal. And we'll explain more that, about that in just a little bit, all right? But I do want to ask you two things. We don't have any food or drink in the auditorium, all right? So if you have something with you, just put a lid on it and just save it for afterwards if you would. And please silence your cell phone. All right, and inevitably they go off at the worst times, and so sometimes some of you aren't normally maybe in church on this time on Sunday, and somebody will call you. So if you'd silent those or turn it off for just a little bit, that'll be a great help to us. Okay, again, thank you for being here. Let's open the service with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, we bow before you in prayer today. We thank you, Lord, for another beautiful Lord's Day that you brought us to, and Lord, this special Sunday that you have seen fit to bless now for 11 years. And Lord, thank you for each one of these guests that have come to be with us this morning. And Lord, we bow before you here at the beginning of the service, and we ask you to meet with us today. Lord, we look forward to enjoying a meal and getting to meet many of these people and talk to them. Yeah. But Lord, here, before that happens, we want you to talk to us, and we want you to meet with us. And so would you control the service this morning? Make it exactly what you would want it to be. I pray that Christ would be lifted up and that all men would be drawn unto him. And so, Lord, I pray that if there's any in the room that have never come to know Christ as their personal Savior, they'd come to know him today. So control the music and our fellowship together. Honor the preaching of your word as only you can do. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. Amen. All right, you may be seated.
Sometimes I feel afraid and seem to be blinded by what I can see and what lies before me. Then Jesus comes and he says, my child, hold on, hold on. When the dark of night surrounds and loneliness and emptiness invade my child, hold on, hold on through the dark times, hold on, though the way seems too long, my grace is sufficient for thee. Out of me.
Wonderful, ladies. Thank you so much. Would you turn with me to 311, 311, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. We'll let you stay seated. The second song in your bulletin there, we'll sing the first, third, and last together on that first. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent, His love is the theme of my song. I'm redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His view. Giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am.
All right. Now, a couple announcements, and then we want to meet you folks that are visiting with us today. Again, at the conclusion of the service, you're going to be given a ticket to be able to go out and enjoy the Thanksgiving meal that we have prepared for you. You will, if you're a parent and you have children here, you'll get enough tickets for you and your children. We're not giving out tickets in the children's area. And so if you have four children down there, five children, you get enough tickets for them. Your ticket's going to have two, it's going to be a two tickets, okay, with a perforated thing in the middle. The one that says, keep this coupon, keep that coupon, okay? The other says, ticket, give that ticket when you go through the line, okay? We have 10 frozen turkeys that we'd like to give away, and we'll pull those tickets out with that number, and if it matches your number, you can take home a turkey for your Thanksgiving. All right, so that's a possibility, so that's why we'll do that, and we'll give those tickets out at the end of the service, and you're going to have a ticket to eat. If you don't have a ticket, that just means you weren't in the service, and then you get to have a nice private sermon by me for 20 minutes before you get to eat. So I'm sure you'd much rather be in the service than have to endure that, all right? And so we will do that at the conclusion of our service. Now, we do ask this, all right? This is for the community, and it's absolutely no charge at all, but we can't have you take plates home, okay? We can't have you load up and take three of your friends who couldn't make it and take it home to them. We just aren't able to do that, okay? So appreciate you helping us out with that, and we thank you for being here. All right, now, we do have an evening service. It's at 6:30 on Sunday evenings, and you're invited back for the service in the Sunday evening, and always a delightful time, and it's different. Sometimes people aren't used to church services. You know, sometimes they think, well, they have two services on Sunday, and they're both the same. They're different service, different songs, different message, and you'll enjoy Sunday night church. It's really a delightful time together, and so you're welcome to come back on Sunday evenings at 6:30. All right. Now, let's take a minute and let's meet the folks. I want to find out who you are and where you're from. We sort of appreciate you coming and being part of our dinner. We have a welcome card to give you and a pen, and we also have a John and Romans we're going to give you as well for every visitor. And so let's just take one side at a time, all right? We'll start here on this side, my right side, your left side. If you're visiting today, you brought a guest with you. I want to stand up and find out who you are and where you're from. And if somebody invited you, tell us who invited you, okay? That's important. We have a little contest going on with who can get the most people here. And it's important you put their name on your card. If Joe invited you, then make sure you put, I'm a guest of Joe, All right. And we that way we'll keep track of who had the most guests here today. All right. But if you're over here and you're here today and you're visiting, let us meet you. Find out who you are and where you're from. Honor us by standing just for a moment, if you would. Just go ahead and stand right on up. That's great. Thank you. Wonderful. Okay. Alan, are you in charge of this group here? Okay. Tell us who you have, Alan. Great, Adam and Charisma. We met them this morning. Great to have you.
My cousin and his wife and the baby is about to pull up in the parking lot any second now.
Oh, okay. They're coming in. All right. That's great. Good, good. Wonderful. Thank you for being here. If he doesn't get in here quick, he will, won't he? All right. Thank you. You can be seated. All right. Was there one on the end right there on the other side of Adam? No? You weren't? Huh? Brian. Okay, Brian. Thank you for being here. God, that's great. Okay, right here. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Cindy Ray. I'm from Reynoldsburg, Ohio, and I'm here with my
Wonderful. Cindy, thank you for being here. Great, from Reynoldsburg. That's wonderful. All right, we're going back. Right here, Tara, our mom.
This is Tom Hopper, and it's my mom's friend, Shirley.
Uh-huh. Great, sure. Good to see you. And Tom, thank you for coming this morning. Thank you. That's great. Wonderful. All right, Leanne? Okay, Rich. Great. Met him earlier, too. Good to see you this morning. Thank you for being here. All right. And right back here. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I'm Bonnie Jackson, and I'm so glad to be here this morning. I was invited.
Well, great. We're glad you're here, too. Great. Thank you for being here. All right. And right back here. Yes, sir. Fantastic. Yes, all right, we're good. All right. That would be the pastor of the church, if we get that. No. You get the award for coming the furthest, that's for sure, amen? And wow, from Denver. But now, somebody here lives in Circleville, right? Who's the Circleville? Grandpa, all right, Grandpa, thank you. Thanks for making the trip up this morning. That's great. Delighted you're here. Okay, right back here.
Gregory and Doreen Barber, we just moved in across the street a few weeks ago.
Fantastic, great. Good to have the neighbors come. Wonderful. Thank you for being here. That's great. Thank you. All right, James, glad to have you. James Spencer is right there. Good to see James this morning. Thank you for being here. All right, Brian. Great. Good to see you again. All right. Great. Good to have your grandparents here from Asheville. Wonderful. Great. Filled your row up. Good job, Campbells. All right. And right behind them. Yes, sir. Great. Daryl, good to have you here this morning. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. All right, Charlie told you to come. Good. Is that you?
Yeah.
All right. Good deal. What Charlie says, Charlie, they do. Amen. Yes, sir. All right, great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you for being here. Great. All right. Now on this side, all of you stand on up, if you would. We'd like to meet you this morning. Great, great. All right, we got some folks on the front row. How about that? Yes, sir. Great. All right, good. Right here in Columbus. Great. Good to have you this morning. Thank you for coming. That's good. All right. And go right behind you. Yes, ma'am. Oh, hi. Good. Trisha, good to meet you. Talked to you on the phone this morning. Great. Good to have you. Yes, sir. Ezra? Okay. Good, good. All right. Quentin, yes? Right next to him? Marcy? Good. All right. Good to have you. Yes, ma'am? Tisha, thank you for being here. All right. Yes, sir? Paul? All right, Paul, thank you for coming. Mr. Steelers, okay. All right, and right behind you, yes, ma'am. Angela, good to have you this morning. Thank you for coming. Yes, ma'am. All right. Great. Good. Amen. Good. All right. Yes, ma'am.
My name is Lawanda
McGinnis,
and I'm from Cincinnati, Ohio, and I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord.
All right. Thank you. All right. Yes, sir. Amen. Glad to have you this morning. Thank you. All right, Andrew, glad you're here. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. There they are. Yes, he is. Amen. Amen. Yes, sir.
My name is Simon.
Wonderful. Okay, great. Good. Amen. Great. Thank you for being here. Yes, ma'am. All right, great. Thank you for coming, ladies. Wonderful. You were going to introduce him, Quentin? Is that what you were going to do? Okay. All right. All right. Wonderful. Make sure now as you fill out the welcome card, if you'd fill that out. In a little bit, we're going to have an offering, and all we want you to do is put that card in there when it goes by and keep the pen, and the John and Romans is our gift to you for coming. Make sure on the card you put down who it was that was responsible for you being here this morning. That'll help us greatly. And again, thank you so much for coming. I think they want something over here, ushers. Is anybody watching? Okay. Lacking a card over here? There we go. Chuck's coming. All right. All set? All right. Very good. Again, thank you for being here. You're our honored guest today, and we look forward to just have a delightful time together and with you, and we hope to get to know some of you when we have a meal together, all right? And let's give all of our guests a warm welcome, shall we?
In the blood of the Lamb.
All right. Well, would you turn with me again to 285, 285. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. You can remain seated. We're going to sing that first and last together. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arm. I'm leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarm. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Amen. That's great singing this morning. Let's go to the front of the book, or on that fourth number there. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. When you find that, if you'd stand with me, let's sing Amazing Grace together.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.
And let's take a couple stanzas, turn around, greet your neighbor, tell them you're glad they're here. We'll come back and sing those last couple stanzas together in a moment.
Many dangers, toils, and snares.
Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace
The instruments drop out. We're going to sing that first verse again. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I'd like us to sing that a cappella. Just sing it up like a mighty choir. All right, let's sing that first together.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Said? Amen. Amen. Great singing. You can be seated. And wow, that sounded great. Good job. Our ushers are coming. We're going to receive our offering this morning. All you need to do if you're a guest is put your card in the offering. We didn't, everything today for you is absolutely free. And we didn't bring you in to get any money from you. We just wanted you to come in so we could give you something to eat and enjoy a church service with you. And thank you for coming. And if you'll put that card in the plate when it goes by, we really appreciate you doing that this morning. All right, let's pray for our offering today. Father, thank you for the privilege that's ours to give. And thank you, Lord, for the giving people of Bible Baptist Church that make days like this possible. Thank you for your provision and how you take care of your church. Now, Father, we pray your blessing on our gift and the giver alike this morning. May it meet the needs of the work of God in this place. In Jesus' name. Amen. To take your Bible this morning, if you have your Bible with you, for our scripture reading, to Luke chapter 15, please. Luke chapter 15. We're going to read the first seven verses of Luke chapter 15, and we read the verses responsibly. We begin together on verse 1, then I read verse 2, then together on verse 3, and we'll alternate reading like that until we end together on verse 7 of Luke chapter 15, Matthew, Mark, Luke, third book of the New Testament. And once you have that, let's stand together to read the scripture, if you would please, all of us standing out of respect to the Word of God. And we'll begin together on verse number 1 of Luke chapter 15. Ready? Then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, This man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness, and go after that which is lost, until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, Rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. And let's pray together, shall we? Father, add your blessing, please, to the reading of our scripture here this morning. And Father, again, I want to thank you for each one who you sent our way today. And Lord, we're asking you now that you would help us to listen carefully to the message from your word. I pray that the songs we've heard today and have helped to put our heart in tune with your heart, that we will be able to hear what you would want to say to each one of us individually this morning. And Lord, I pray your blessing on the special now as it's sung. And Lord, may each of us listen carefully to the words, and may it help us to keep our thoughts and our minds stayed on you for these next few minutes we have together. It's in Jesus' name I ask it. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
I'm not on an ego trip. I'm nothing on my own. I make mistakes, I often slip. Just common flesh and bone. But I'll prove someday just why I sing. I'm of a special kind. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So unworthy of such mercy. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. A look of love was on his face, and thorns were on his head. Blood was on his scarlet robe, stained in crimson red. Though his eyes were on the crowd that day, he looked ahead in time. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. Shine, so unworthy of such mercy. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind.
Amen. Now, Father, we bow before you in prayer as we come to the the message from your word this morning. And Father, I pray this morning that you'd help each individual that's here today and to give their full attention to the only book you've ever written. And I pray, Lord, that each one today would listen carefully to hear what you would want to say to their heart this morning. Help me as I bring the message, and please help every individual as they listen. And I pray, Lord, that you would do a work in each one of our lives, each one of our hearts, that only you can do. And I'll thank you in advance for what I believe you'll do this morning. It's in Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. In Luke chapter 15, and you can have your Bible open there if you have one with you, and if not, just listen carefully. There are two kinds of people in the world. Some of you might have heard that saying before, and I'm going to explain that just a little bit. Some people say there's two kinds of people in the world, those who have things happen to them and those who make things happen. Somebody else says there's two kinds of people in the world, those who know what's going on and those who wonder what's going on. But the truth is, spiritually speaking, there are only two kinds of people in the world. And it is saved or lost. Saved people are what the Bible would call lost people. And to be saved, and by the way, saved is a Bible word, and it's the opposite of lost. To be saved means that you have a purpose in life, that you have direction, that your future is certain. To be lost means that you do not have a purpose, there is no direction, and your future is uncertain. The Bible says in Acts 16 and verse 31, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. In Romans 10 and verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So saved is a good Bible word. We just sang a few minutes ago, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. 'Twas blind, but now I see. The contrast between saved and lost. Those who know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior are saved. Those who have never accepted Christ as their personal Savior and believed on Him from their heart are lost. You can have a great education and be lost. You can have a nice home and drive a nice car and be lost. You can be a church member and go to church every Sunday and be lost. There are many different things that you could be. You could be well respected in the community and still be lost. Jesus Christ came to seek and to save that which was lost. And here in Luke 15, you really have some think three different parables. Maybe others think there's three parts of one parable. But it's all about lost things. There's a lost sheep. Then there's a lost coin. And then there's a lost son. And you'll find out today there might be two lost sons here. But it's all about the lost. And I want to talk to you this morning just briefly. Four reasons why people are lost. Four reasons why people are lost. And it's right here in Luke chapter 15. Words that are spoken, by the way, by the Lord Jesus. So the message is not original with me. It is original with Jesus in Luke chapter 15. And so I want to share this with you this morning. Notice the very first reason that Jesus gives as to why people are lost is ignorance. Ignorance. It's the story of the lost sheep. A shepherd has 100 sheep. And as the nighttime comes and he begins to count his sheep up, he finds he gets up to 95, 96, 97, 98, 99, 99, 99, 99. There's one missing. He may have counted them again, and there's still one missing. And so he realizes, I've got one lost. And the story goes that the shepherd goes out to seek for that sheep, and he looks for the sheep until he finds it. And when he finds that sheep, he puts that sheep on his shoulders and he brings it back to the other sheep, and they're rejoicing that they found the lost sheep. Now, we know that sheep are not the smartest animals on the planet. Okay? And it's kind of ironic, isn't it, that the Lord likens us to sheep? I'm not sure what that's saying about us, but it says something. Sheep are just not the most intelligent of animals. You know why sheep get lost? They don't know any better. They don't know any better. If they don't follow the shepherd and they don't listen to the shepherd, they'll get lost. Hey, I'm talking to some people this morning. You're lost simply because you don't know any better. You're just ignorant. No one's ever told you how you don't have to be lost. No one's ever told you how you could be saved. I meet people nearly every week of my life when I ask them, has anyone ever taken a Bible and showed you from the Bible how you can know for sure that you have eternal life? And you know what the answer is most times? No. No one's ever done that. See, it's not that they're mad about it or rebellious about it. They just don't know. They're ignorant. Two fellows were betting on who knew the Lord's Prayer better. And so they were arguing about who knew it better, and one says, all right, you go first. The other guy says, no, you go first. No, you go first. The other guy said, no, you go first. I said, all right, I'll go first. And the fellow started, now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the... And the other fellow said, oh, you don't have to say anymore. You win. So neither one of them knew very well, did they? They were both ignorant. But many people are like, there's a fellow in Acts chapter 8, and you don't have to turn there, but a fellow had been, he's a Jewish proselyte, and he'd been in Jerusalem for a feast, and he's going back to his home country in Ethiopia, and he's reading a scroll of the Bible as he goes back in his chariot. He's reading a scroll of Isaiah. And as he reads, he's reading Isaiah chapter 53. And it's all about the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. And as he reads that passage, the Lord has Philip, a Christian, join himself to this chariot and ride with this man. And as the man reads it, you know what he asked Philip? He said, who is this man talking about? Is he talking about himself or somebody else? What was he admitting? I don't know who this is. I don't know who this is that he's talking about going to die for our sins. Who is he talking about? And he was just ignorant. And Philip, the Bible says, opened that same scripture and began to preach unto him Jesus. And it wasn't long before that eunuch believed in Jesus Christ as his Savior. Ignorance. There's people here this morning. Listen, you would be saved. You would accept Christ if you only knew how. If somebody would just tell you what you have to do to be saved. Well, I got good news for you. After this morning, you won't be ignorant anymore. You're going to hear in just a few moments how exactly you can know Jesus is your Savior. But the first reason people are lost is ignorance. Now, the second reason people are lost starts in verse number 8. And in verse number 8, you have a woman that has 10 coins. All right? And as she has the coins, you find out she loses one of them. So she has 9 coins, but she's looking for this 10th coin. It's very valuable. It's very important to her. And so she's looking for the coin. The second reason then that we find that people are lost is carelessness. That's how you lose stuff, is carelessness. Ever put something down somewhere and then a while later, you think you're going to go pick it up. You don't remember where you put it down? Huh? If you're over 12, you've probably done that. If you're over 50, I know you've done that. And you think, man, it's so... we have a... No, I won't say that. But we... You don't remember. It's so easy to forget things. And you're just careless. You think, man, I wish I'd have thought and really made sure I knew this is what I'm doing with this. Because when you get careless about it, you lose it. She didn't lose the coin on purpose. She was just careless. Did you know a lot of people are careless about their soul? They're careless about eternity. Careless about what God has given to them, which is a never-dying soul. Oh, I'm not talking to people this morning who don't know they need to be saved or don't know how to be saved. They know they need to be saved. They know Christ died on the cross for their sins. And they know they need to trust Him as their Savior. And you're going to do that, but just not right now. And I would say you're being careless with your soul. You're being very careless. Do that sometime, but just not right now. You know what happens? Life gets busy. Life, I got news for you. As you get older, life doesn't slow down. It gets faster, gets busier. The days and the weeks and the months and the years start clicking off. It's amazing. And know what happens? You end up lost instead of saved. Even though you intended to get saved. And by the way, I think that's the devil's favorite tool. I don't believe the devil's favorite tool is to tell you the Bible's not true, Jesus isn't the Son of God, don't believe any of that stuff. No, no, no. I think the devil says, man, that's true. Jesus loves you. He died for you. You need to receive Him as your Savior, but you don't need to do it now. Just wait. You're young. Have fun. Do what you want to do. Man, before you die, you can get saved. The problem is you don't know when you're going to die. You don't know when death will come. Everybody in the Bible, there once was a man named Felix who Paul was witnessing to, trying to explain to him how he could know he's going to heaven. The Bible says Felix was very much under conviction. God was dealing with him. In fact, he was trembling. And he told Paul, he says, I'll call for you again. He says, it's not real convenient right now. I'll call you at a more convenient time. And then I'll believe what you say. But as far as we find in the Bible, you know what? The convenient time never came. Never came. Don't put it off. You may have, listen to me carefully, you may have other opportunities to receive Christ as your Savior after this morning. I don't know that. And you don't know that. But I do know this, you'll never have a better opportunity to receive Him as your Savior than you have right now this morning. Don't be careless with it. Don't be careless and throw away another opportunity for you to be saved. What doth it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Men are lost because, number one, they're ignorant. Number two, because they're careless. The third part of the parable, or the third parable here, is it starts in verse 11, where it says, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country. And he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would have fain filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat. And no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father. And I'll say unto him, I've sinned against heaven and before thee. And I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. He arose and came to his father. When he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion on him and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I've sinned against heaven in thy sight. I'm no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. We see the third reason why people are lost, and that is rebelliousness. This boy decided, give me my inheritance. He wasn't the oldest, he was the second oldest. But he says, I get an inheritance and I'm ready to take it. I'm ready to face the world. I'm ready to face life. And by the way, he wasn't. But he got the inheritance, just rebelling, didn't want to live at home, too many rules, too many regulations. I'm tired of people telling me what to do. I'm 15, I'm 17, you know. It was Mark Twain who said, you know, when you're child turns to be a teenager, you ought to put him in a box and nail it shut and cut a little hole in it so they can breathe. But then he said when they turn 17, plug the hole up. Now, I don't know about that, but, you know, this fella, this young man was rebellious. He didn't want to listen to his dad anymore. He didn't want to listen to what the rules and the regulations were. He didn't want a curfew anymore. He wanted to do his own thing. He wanted to go his own way. He rebelled, and he went his own way with inheritance, and the Bible says he lived it up. Prodigal son simply means wasteful. He did that in wasteful living. He was a partying, and whether he got computers and iPhones and Xboxes and cars and trucks and what video games, whatever he was enjoying the pleasures of sin for a season. And he lived it up until the money ran out. And he ends up on a pig farm. That's hitting bottom for a Jewish boy. Slopping the pigs. And guess what? He was so hungry, the slop for the pigs was looking pretty good. He says, what am I doing here? People at home who work for my dad, they have it better than I do. I've been such a fool. The Bible says he came to himself. And he says, I'm going to go home to my father. The great news is, when he came home to dad, guess what? Dad was looking for him. And it wasn't as far home as he thought it was, because dad came running out to meet him. I got a hunch dad could run faster than him. And he was going to cut that distance down. And he welcomed him home. And there's some here today, listen to me. You know how to be saved. You've heard the plan of salvation. You could tell someone else how to be saved. But you're not saved because you're rebellious. You're rebellious. You're just plain stubborn. And you won't come the way God says you must come. Oh, my friend, don't die and go to hell just because you're rebellious, that you don't want to go God's way. My friend, God's way is not a way. It's the only way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. Lay down your rebellion today. God is waiting for you. God will run to meet you. He died for you, the Bible says. Christ died for us. He took our place. The songwriter wrote years ago, the Savior's waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let Him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. Why don't you let Him come in? Time after time, He's waited before. And now, He's waiting again. To see if you're willing to open the door. Oh, how He wants to come in. Would you open your heart's door to Christ this morning? Don't be rebellious. There's a fourth part of the parable here that we see, starting in verse number 25 to the end of the chapter. Fourth person we meet, we saw the sheep, we saw the coin, we see the younger son, the prodigal son, but now we see an elder brother. If you notice with me in verse number 25, now his elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound. And he was angry. He would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, lo, these many years I served thee, and neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. Yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which had devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed him for the fatted calf, or killed him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet, or it was right, that we should make merry and be glad. For this thy brother was dead and is alive again, was lost and is now found. First reason people are lost was the sheep, ignorance. The second reason was the coin, carelessness. Third reason is the younger brother, the prodigal, who is rebellious. But the fourth reason is the elder brother, and he was self-righteous. Self-righteous. He wasn't happy younger brother came home. He wasn't happy that he had come home and there was a big party for him. He heard the laughter and the singing, but he said, I'm not having any part of that. There's something wrong when you don't rejoice over someone else coming back to Christ or coming to know Christ as their Savior. One of the great indications that you truly are saved and that you know Christ your Savior is that you want other people to know Him. You want other people to know they're on their way to heaven. My friend, nobody who's truly saved, nobody who's truly on the way to heaven wants to go there alone. You have people you love and people you care about that you want to go with you. And this fellow was self-righteous. Think about this. You get excited when the boss says you're going to get a raise at work. You get excited when your tax return is coming back and you're going to get a big refund. We get excited when the Buckeyes win. And we get excited when the Buckeyes win and Michigan loses. But you know what? Jesus gets excited when one person repents of their sin and asks Him to be their Savior. That's what gets heaven excited. That's what gets Jesus excited. Oh, when one without Christ, one who was lost, comes to Christ and now they're saved. Oh, the Bible says there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God because somebody has come to know Christ as their Savior. Someone who was lost and on their way to hell is now saved and on their way to heaven. What rejoicing takes place. And if you don't rejoice at people being saved, you might be lost. You might be self-righteous, but lost. Now, if you're here this morning, look right at me. If you're here this morning and you say, you know, preacher, as you preach that message, I believe I might be on the lost side. I don't think I'm on the saved side. Let me help you this morning. There's four simple things taken from the book of Romans in the Bible that God says if we'll understand them and believe them, we can have His guarantee of going to heaven when we die. And God says, first thing you have to understand is that all of us have sinned in God's sight. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All have sinned. What does all mean? Everybody. I've sinned against God. You've sinned against God. All of us have. There is none righteous. No, not one. So all of us are sinful before God. We're guilty before God. And God says, secondly, that there's a price that must be paid for sin. Romans 6 and verse 23 says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's focus on that first part. The wages of sin is death. We know what wages are. Wages are what you work for. Wages are what you earn. On a paycheck, sometimes it'll say wages and earnings. So I know this is what I've received for the work I've done. And God says if we got our paycheck from Him, our wages for sinning against Him, we deserve death. Death is separation. When God talks about death, He means separation from God. And the place you're separated from God is in a place called hell. And by the way, we'd be deserving to go there. We're guilty. We're guilty. I'm guilty before God. You're guilty before God. God would be absolutely righteous and just to send us to hell because that's what we deserve. We've sinned before Him, and that's the penalty for sin is death and hell separated from God. Here's the third thing. And by the way, that's not great news, but it is true news, and it is honest news. But let me give you the third thing, and listen to me. God didn't create you, nor did He create me to be separated from Him in hell. He created us to be with Him in heaven. But God cannot be righteous and overlook our sin. Sometimes people say, well, God's just going to let everybody go to heaven. Bless your heart. Huh? Well, wait a minute. If everybody goes to heaven, then heaven would become just like earth. I've never heard any describe earth as it's just like heaven. I've heard him describe earth as the other place. Okay? I asked for the cell phones to go off. What's happening? Got it? Okay. So we understand, listen, God has to find a way to show us He loves us, but at the same time, to show us that He's righteous and He's just. Here's what He did. Number three, God sent His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to live a perfect, sinless life and then die on the cross as a payment for our sin. The Bible says God commendeth, or He proved His love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He did it for you. He did it for me. He took our place. He was our substitute. Jesus Christ was the Son of God, and being the Son of God, the Bible says He never committed a single sin. Jesus was tempted at all points like we are, yet He never sinned. I want you to think about this. Had He never sinned, and He didn't, would He have to pay the wages of sin? He would not. There was none to pay for. But He went to the cross, and He hung there, and He bled, and He died. Because the wages of sin is death. So He paid the wages of sin. But it wasn't His sins. He didn't have any. Whose sins was Jesus dying for? Our sins. Your sins. My sins. He took that day on the cross. He took every sin that Stan Slabaugh has ever committed. And even sins I haven't committed yet, but He knows I will. He laid all my sins on Himself, and He said, God punish me instead of Stan Slabaugh. He took all of Quentin Dunmore's sins. He put them on Himself. He said, God punish me instead of Quentin Dunmore. You see, He took all of your sin and said, God punish me, and not put your name in there. He died for you. You know what happened? 3 days after He died, what took place? Yeah, resurrection. He rose from the dead. God raised Him from the dead, the Bible says. You know what God was saying? God was saying, I'm accepting my Son's payment for the sins of mankind. And listen carefully this morning. That's what God says each of us must do. We must, by faith, accept Jesus Christ and His payment for our sin as our hope for heaven. And He will give us the gift of eternal life, and we shall be saved. The last part of verse 23, we said the wages of sin is death. The last part says the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now God says eternal life is His gift. Well, we talked about wages. That's what you work for. That's what you earn. But gifts are not that way, is it? Christmas isn't far away. You'll receive gifts. Your birthday, you receive a gift. You understand when that gift is in front of you that somebody worked for it. Somebody paid for it so you could have it as a free gift. When it's your birthday, when the gifts are there in front of you, you don't pull your wallet out and say, okay, what do I owe everybody? Why? Because you know it's a gift. They've already worked for it. They've already paid for it. Why is it that when people, you ask people about how you can have eternal life, they start telling you what they have to do? Well, you got to go to church. Well, you got to keep the commandments. Well, you got to try to live a good life. Well, you got to do this. Wait a minute. God said it was a gift. If it's a gift, look this way. If it's a gift, then it's already been paid for. Well, if it's a gift and it's already been paid for, who paid for the gift of eternal life? Jesus Christ did when He died on the cross. That's why the verse says the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. See, eternal life is not through anything we do. It's through what's already been done for us. Jesus did it already. Really, I tell people all the time, look this way. I tell people all the time, you can put all the religions of the world and you can put them under two headings. One says do. Do this, do that, do this. And every religion has a different list of what you got to do. But the other heading would be done, D-O-N-E. It's nothing you do. It's what's already been done for you by Jesus Christ. And you, by faith, trust what He's done for you. That's why the Bible says in Romans 10 and verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And when you call on Jesus as your Savior and you say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner and I know that I deserve to pay for my sins in hell. But I believe, Jesus, you died on the cross. You paid my sin debt for me. You were buried and you rose again. And that's important because only a living Savior can save you. And you would say, I now trust you. Trust in the Bible means you put your weight on it. Okay? You have your weight in the chair you're sitting in. You know why? You trust it. So you put all your weight on it. And salvation in the Bible is when you put all your weight on Jesus Christ and say, I'm going to trust only what He's done for me. I'm not trusting what I've done. I'm not trusting where I go to church. I'm not trusting anything I do. I'm trusting what He's done for me. And God says, when you do that, you shall be saved. Not might be saved, not hope to be saved, not may be saved. You shall be saved. And then you receive His gift of eternal life. My friend, that's a guarantee. Not from me, but in writing from God in the Bible. That if you put your faith and trust in Jesus alone as your Savior, He'll give you the gift of eternal life. Now, once you receive Him as your Savior, once you receive Him as your Savior, the next thing you should do after you're saved is you should be baptized. Baptism doesn't save you. Baptism is like a wedding ring. When you see me with a wedding ring on my finger, what's that tell you about me? It tells you I'm married. I'm committed to somebody. It means one day I stood before a preacher and I said, I do. My wife said, she did. And the preacher said, you are. And we were married. Okay? Now, some people can't wear a ring. They maybe get allergic reactions or somebody does certain jobs and they can't wear it. Does that mean they're not married? No, they're still married. They're married because they said, I do. If you don't get baptized, you're still saved because you put your faith in Jesus Christ. But I wouldn't think much of a fella or a woman who has a wedding ring and refuses to wear one. Can you imagine if the wedding takes place and the reception takes place and everybody's standing outside? I guess you don't throw rice anymore. You throw bird seed or blow bubbles at them or something now. But they go out to get in the car, and you see the groom go out, and he opens up the back door to the car. And the bride looks at him and says, what are you doing? He says, just get in the back seat, would you? Well, that wouldn't be such a good thing. And he goes around and gets in the front seat, and he says, would you mind just laying down on the back seat? Well, in fact, would you mind just getting on the floor? You know, she might have a problem with that, do you think? I think maybe she get the idea, are you ashamed of me or something? And by the way, no groom ever treats his bride that way. Why? He's not ashamed of his decision he's made. That's all baptism is. It's saying, I'm not ashamed of what Jesus has done for me. When you get baptized, you go into the water, and you say, I'm buried in the likeness of Jesus' death, and I'm raised in the likeness of His resurrection. And you're letting all these people know that Jesus died, He was buried, and He rose again for me. See, that's all that is, just obedience to His command. When Jesus told us to go and preach the gospel, He said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, and then He said, baptize them. You preach the gospel, what's the gospel? That Christ died for your sins, that He was buried, He rose again the third day. You by faith trust Him, and then you follow Him in baptism. It's really very simple. It's not a hard thing to do. But I tell you what, if God made it hard or God made it easy, I like easy. If you have a choice between something that's hard and something that's easy, what would you like to do? Yeah, I'll do easy. Why don't you do the easy thing? Receive His gift of eternal life today. But look at me, look at me. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Calling in the Bible means prayer. And so I want us to bow our heads right now in prayer, shall we? Every head bowed, every eye closed. Just between you and God right now. Just between you and God. I'm going to pray in just a moment. But if you're here this morning and you realize this morning that I'm lost, but if I can call on Jesus today and trust Him as my Savior and receive His gift of eternal life, that He'll forgive my sin, He'll write my name down in heaven, and I will be saved. My friend, you need to call on Jesus. Now, I will help you this morning with a prayer. Let me make sure you understand something. If all you do is repeat the words that I say, then it won't mean a thing. God is looking at your heart this morning. And if you from your heart will trust Jesus Christ as your Savior this morning, then maybe you'd pray something like this. Dear God, I know that I'm a sinner. Please forgive me of my sin. I now trust you, Jesus, and you alone as my Savior to give me the gift of eternal life and one day take me to heaven. Thank you, Jesus, for dying for me. Please help me to live for you. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'm going to finish praying in just a moment. But I wonder if you're here this morning and you would say, Pastor, I prayed just a minute ago and from my heart, I've asked Jesus Christ to be my Savior. I've made that decision this morning. The Bible says, Jesus said, whosoever believes on me should not be ashamed. If you're not ashamed of that decision and you say, I've received His gift of eternal life this morning, I've trusted Jesus as my Savior, I want you to stand to your feet right now. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. If that's you, just stand up. That's right. That's right. That's right. Just stand on up. Anybody else join these? Say, I prayed this morning, I asked Jesus to be my Savior. With their heads bowed and eyes closed, no one's, well, I'm going to pray just a moment. I want you folks to come up here and see me. Would you come that right now? That's right, Danny. Thank you. That's right. That's right. And carefully, while these are coming and they're being dealt with, there's time for you to come. If you've never received Christ as your Savior, why don't you come this morning? You may have another time to be saved, but I know you won't have a better time than right now to be saved. There's opportunity for you to come. Will you come? Will you receive Him as your Savior today? Don't pass up the gift. That's right. That's right. He'll let you out. That's good. Brother Bowman. Came, should you come this morning? Folks will be more than glad to allow you out.
Lord, watch me just now, as in thy presence, humbly I bow.
Don't be careless with your soul. Don't be ignorant. You're not ignorant any longer. You know how to be saved now. Will you come? Come and receive His gift of eternal life. Don't be rebellious. I'd hate to die and go to hell and realize, man, I really meant to get saved. I just never did it in time. Will you come this morning?
Spirit, till all shall see. Christ only, always living in me. Have thine own way, Lord, have thine own way. Thou art the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will, while I am well.
All right. Listen carefully now, if you will. We rejoice in the decisions been made this morning. Thank you for your patience and praying for the decisions that are being made. We're glad to have Greg Greenlee coming this morning. Greg's right here. Greg, you received Christ as your Savior this morning. God bless you, brother. That's great. And he's going to follow the Lord in baptism today as well. That's great, Greg. You go with Brother Bob right there, and he'll go down and get you ready for that. That's wonderful. We're also glad to have Clinton Henry coming this morning. And Clinton's right here. Stand up for us, Clinton. Clinton also received Christ as his Savior this morning. God bless you, Clinton. Thank you. Amen. Austin Montgomery. Austin, right here? Is it? Austin, you received Christ as your Savior this morning? God bless you, my friend. That's great. Congratulations. Charisma Walters. Charisma's right here. And Charisma, you accepted Christ as your Savior? God bless you, young lady. That's great. Congratulations. And then I have Elaine. Is that Rowoth? Elaine? Oh, Elaine went back here. Okay. Elaine accepted Christ as her Savior this morning. God bless you, Elaine. That's good. All right. And then we also had Danny Moore. Danny's over here on the side. Danny rededicates his life to Christ this morning. All right. He's been saved. Just coming back to God. Amen. That's great. And I think we're still dealing with somebody over here. We'll let them continue on that. And we'll go down and get ready to baptize Greg this morning. All right. Okay, he needs to make that public and get a card filled out on him, okay? You bring him forward, okay? All right?
Amen. Amen. All right. I'd like to sing a couple songs. Pray it'll bless your heart. I was drifting away on life's pitiless sea, and the angry wave threatened my ruin to be. When away at my side, there I dimly descried a stately old vessel, and loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy, ship ahoy!" And loudly I cried, "Ship ahoy!" 'Twas the old ship of Zion, the sailing along. All aboard her seemed joyous, I heard their sweet song. And the captain's kind ear, ever ready to hear, caught my wail of distress as I cried out in fear. Ship ahoy, ship ahoy, as I cried out in fear. Ship ahoy. The good captain commanded a boat to be lowered, and with tender compassion, he took me on board. And I'm happy today, all my sins washed away in the blood of my Savior. And now I can say, bless the Lord, bless the Lord. From my soul I can say, bless the Lord. Oh, soul sinking down, neath sin's merciless wave, the strong arm of our captain, he's mighty to save. Then trust him today, no longer delay, board that old ship of Zion and shout on your way. Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Shout and sing on your way, Jesus saves. talks about how wonderful of a Savior we have.
Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and found a Savior to save a poor lost soul like me. Oh, what a Savior! Oh, hallelujah! His heart was broken on Calvary. His hands were nails scarred, his side was riven. He gave his life blood for even me. He left the Father with all his riches, with calmness sweet and serene. Came down from heaven and gave his life's blood to make the vilest sinner clean. Oh, what a Savior! Oh, hallelujah! His heart was broken on Calvary. His hands were nails scarred, his side was riven. He gave his life's blood for even me. Death's chilly waters I'll soon be crossing. His hand will lead me safe o'er. I'll join that chorus in that great city, and I'll sing up there forevermore. Oh, what a Savior! Oh, hallelujah! His heart was broken on Calvary. His nails were nail scarred, his side was riven. He gave his life blood for even me. He gave his life's blood for even me.
This is Mercy Campbell. Mercy was saved as a teenage girl, but never been baptized, and wants to obey the Lord in baptism. Mercy, upon a public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, raised in the likeness of Jesus' life. This is Greg Greenlee. Greg, upon the public profession of your faith in Christ as your Savior, and in obedience to his command, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bearing the likeness of Jesus' death, and raised in the likeness of Jesus' life. Spirit has done us how it's commanded, and yet there is room.
Amen.
Well, I'd like you to sing with me, if you would. Let's go to 448. There should be a songbook in front of you, underneath the chair in front of you. If you would, you can remain seated. But we're going to sing 488, A New Name in Glory. 488. I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. Let's sing all three verses together, all right? I was once a sinner, but I came pardon to receive from my Lord. This was freely given, and I found that He always kept His word. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown, when the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, oh, the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole. There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. And the white angels sing the story. A sinner has come home, for there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine, oh yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, nevermore to roam. Oh, man, that's great. I tell you, what a good song for this morning. Ushers, why don't you come on down with the tickets. Pastor will resume this momentarily, but we'll go ahead and get started. Speaking of whom? All right. Pastor will give us some direction here.
Okay, now you want to put up in your hand how many tickets you have, if you have children especially, so we know we get you enough tickets, okay? Everybody in your family needs a ticket to eat. All right, so go ahead, ushers, and start. Like, you do the first row. Don't both of you do the same row. One of you do one row, one of you do the other row, okay? Yeah, put your hand up. Tell him how many. He's got to see how many tickets you need. And you'll actually have two. You'll have one that says ticket, one that says save this coupon. I think the one that says save this coupon, you ought to save. There you go. Okay. Should be ready to go. I have servers left. Yep. Servers, if you're in the line to serve our people, you can go. Ticket to people, they should go. Elizabeth Farrell accepted Christ as his Savior? No. Bobby Wright, this doesn't make sense. Who is this? And we need to. Okay, we need to bring her up here and let's talk to her, okay? All right. Thank you. Just have a seat right here, Elizabeth. We'll talk to you in just a moment. Thank you. Thank you, Bobby. Mrs. Yoder. We're going to pray before you go over, so don't anybody leave yet, and we'll let you go get your children. Thank you, Brother Bowman. Okay, good. Everybody have a ticket that wants one? Oh, thank you. Brother Linderman, will you take a quick run over there and ask if they're ready for us to come? Okay. When you go into the fellowship hall, you'll see there, you'll go down and there'll actually be two serving lines. So you can go, you'll go through the one line, give your ticket. Then once you give the ticket, you can go to two different lines. So there'll be somebody there to help you, get you through there. Then everybody eats out in the tent, the big tent out back, okay? And it should be beautiful. Thank you for coming.
Amen.
Appreciate so much you being here today. And I hope you enjoy the meal. And if you have any prayer requests, anything we can pray with you about or anything we can talk to you about, feel free to grab one of us and we'll be happy to do that with you. Okay? Oh, it's okay, Bob. It's all right. Just wait on Chuck Linderman. Once he gives us the green light, we'll turn you loose. We'll pray, and then we'll turn you loose to get your children. And how are we getting them? How are they getting their kids out of the tent and people going in to the tent? Outside?
Yeah.
If you have children in the first through sixth grade children's church, that's under the tent. You'll want to go outside to the left around the fellowship hall to this side of the tent, and the flap is open, and you'll be able to get your children. Then come around and get in line. All right? Most of you know where the 3 through 5 year old classroom is in the nursery, and you can get your kids from there as well. All right, let's stand together. We'll ask a blessing on our meal, all right? Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the decisions that were made for you today. Thank you for these that have received Christ as their Savior and these who have obeyed you in baptism. And Father, thank you for meeting with us today. Lord, I do pray for those in the room who maybe have yet to decide for Christ. Lord, I pray they'd understand they made a decision this morning. And it's not the one that you desire nor the one we would desire. But I pray, Lord, that they would continue to think on the things they've heard. And before the sun will go down tonight, they'll get on their knees and ask Christ to be their Savior. Father, thank you now for the food that's before us today. Thank you for the many hands that have prepared it and labored over it. I pray that you will use it to nourish our bodies, Lord, and that you'll bless our fellowship, our conversation over the food, that the things we say would be pleasing in your sight. And be with each one of our guests, and they travel to their different homes, and give them safety. Lord, help us to enjoy our time together now today. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you are dismissed. Thank you. The family of God.